Hello and welcome to the third episode of Historians in Cars Getting Coffee, which I realise I misnamed in the first two episodes. I got the words in the wrong order. So sorry, Jerry Seinfeld. Please forgive us. For this third episode, we've done two things. We've got more coffee. We're quite traumatised from the experience of... Well, Al and I are anyway. Warren's used to this, but English people try to buy coffee in an American coffee shop without like French salted caramel in it. You know, we managed it, but it was a bit traumatic. Anyway, before we get to the history, so we've got coffee and we've added a historian. So this is Alan Packwood, who is director of the Churchill Archive Centre in Cambridge, who has just given a brilliant talk at the International Churchill Society Tennessee branch.
World-renowned historian and living legend, Alan Packwood.
Yep. Currently struggling with hazelnut coffee with, I think, vanilla milk.
Was it good?
Is it vanilla coffee with hazelnut milk?
Either way around, it's different, but okay.
that's the slogan that they'll be using from now on. Different but okay. Now, as I say, Alan's just given a brilliant talk, and it was on Churchill's D-Day, which is the new book which he has just published. And so, tell us, Alan, what was the theme of your talk? Give us a couple of quick headlines.
So the book is co-authored with General Lord Dannett. I should point that out. So. And the theme of the book really is to strip away the layers of hindsight and subsequent interpretation about D-Day, and to try and look at it in depth and in context, and to look in particular at why D-Day couldn't really happen before June 1944. So what were the preconditions that had to be met before you could launch an operation of that scale and complexity?
And I must say, I thought you did a brilliant job of showing the complexity, which you emphasised, but also the emotions. You know, you focused on the film which came out in 2017, just called Churchill, not to be confused, of course, with the other film about Churchill that came out in 2017, Darkest Hour. Do you want to say a little bit about the film and the picture that he's presented in there?
I mean, of those two films, the real Winston Churchill would probably have liked the film Churchill with Gary Oldman. Film Darkest Hour with Gary Oldman portraying him. He certainly wouldn't have liked the film Churchill, where he was portrayed by Brian Cox, because the basic premise of the film is that in the 48 hours immediately before D-Day, Churchill is trying to oppose the military plan and stop the military plan, and where no one will heed his warnings, takes to his bed and becomes a sort of gibbering wreck.
But you rightly pointed out that, you know, in fact what he wanted to do, his instinct was to, you know, jump up and dash out to watch the landings taking place from HMS Belfast or a destroyer. So actually that gives a very different picture of yes, he was certainly anxious, as you know, who wouldn't be, but he kind of manifested in a quite a different way.
I was surprised, Alan, actually you did not mention the name of the operation, which was, as I recall, Operation WC, which was called that, of course, for water closet, because they hated the idea so much. You'd think it's Winston Churchill, but it was for water closet. I don't know if that's true. I had heard that.
I don't know if that's true either. It's great if true, and I should investigate it. But I mean, what is certainly true is that I think Churchill was one of those people who liked to be at the centre of events, the centre of action. And I think what you see with Churchill is that he gets most frustrated when there is no action. He hates periods of enforced inactivity. Yes. And waiting around. And that's really what you see, of course, in the run-up to D-Day. The military decisions are now being taken by Eisenhower and by his team. everything is being assembled, everything is in motion, but nothing is yet happening. And I think he finds that very difficult. And his response is to want to get as close to the action as possible. So he basically asks Admiral Ramsay, who is in charge of the naval operation, Operation Neptune, to draw up plans that would have seen the British Prime Minister embarking on HMS Belfast on D-1, and then transferring to a destroyer for a short tour of the beaches if it was safe to do so. Absolute madness, of course, and the last thing that any of the military commanders wanted was Churchill anywhere near the action on D-Day itself. He would have been a huge distraction, and of course he would have been away from London and Whitehall for any key political decisions that needed to be taken. But he has an audience with the king. He tells the king that this is what he wants to do, at which point, of course, King George VI says, well, I'm a sailor, I want to go too, which alarms everybody around them. And it falls really on Sir Alan Lascelles, the king's private secretary, to talk the king down and then tell the king that he has to tell Churchill that he can't go either. But even then, it takes two handwritten letters from King George VI to Winston Churchill. The second one, written as late as June the 2nd, 1944. And remember, the original date for D-Day was the 5th of June, so D-1, when Churchill would have been boarding that cruiser, would have been the 4th of June. But the second letter as late as the 2nd of June, before Churchill grudgingly concedes to His Majesty's wishes and indeed commands.
Well, here at Historian Tea Cars Getting Coffee, we also like to be close to the scene of the action.
That's very true.
You know, so
I would just like to say, I still think Brian Cox's performance was great in that film, and I love Brian Cox. This is in no way a representation of Brian Cox.
No, I mean, it was an all-star cast with Brian Cox and Miranda Richardson.
Yeah.
But it didn't have the budget that
Darkest Hour.
Darkest Hour.
And we don't have the budget either, but we do have coffee. So join us soon for another episode.